I'm speaking from a perspective of someone who is the head of the air office at EPA for several years, and a little bit about the potential regulatory barriers that that might exist that would make it more difficult for alternative fuels such as ethanol or methanol to compete in the light duty fleet. I do need to disclose at the outset that I have actually done some consulting for a group called Fuel Freedom Foundation that has helped us to sponsor this study. This is an issue that I've thought a little bit about, and I will tell you, when I first got involved in this project, I came in with the preconception that there likely was some significant regulatory barriers for people and companies who wanted to convert vehicles to operate on other fuels besides E10. The other thing I will say by way of introduction is my interest in this project really came about because of something that Dick and others have said, which is for the first time in my professional career in Washington dealing with these issues, it really does look like there is an alternative fuel that would be economically attractive if there were a way to allow it to compete in the marketplace. So to this point, we've relied on subsidies and mandates and other things to try to force fuel into the transportation sector. It now looks, based on the work that RFF and others have done, that there really is a value proposition for consumers, which I think this makes this very different. And as Dick and others have said, at least in the near term, the fuel that looks like it is most likely to compete would be E85 by virtue of the fact that there are something in the neighborhood of 10 million existing vehicles that are certified to operate on that fuel. One of the things that we looked at in terms of either regulatory barriers or regulatory benefits that could come from switching to alternative fuels is what are the opportunities for E85 to exist in the existing fleet? Again, we've talked about the 10 million, or some people say it's up to as many as 14 million FFVs that are out there today. But the other there at least are claims that very low cost conversion kits could be used to convert a number of other vehicles to operate on E85. 2 years ago, EPA actually conducted a rulemaking to try to make it easier for people to certify those conversion kits. And I won't go through all of the details, but I do want to say this. It is still rather expensive and cumbersome because of EPA's certification process to get permission to use a conversion kit on a relatively new car, a car that's a current model year or a year old. Once you get beyond that point, there is a relatively low-cost option. And once vehicles get beyond their useful life, it looks like there's an option that would be very low-cost for conversion kit manufacturers. But there's one other thing that is not addressed in EPA's regulations that I think does merit some consideration, and that is the fact that we've heard about today, we've heard about from other manufacturers over time, that there are a number of cars that are not certified, that are not flagged as being FFVs, but in fact are nearly identical to cars that have been certified as FFVs. And I believe that there should be a way within EPA's existing regulations to allow people to operate those cars on E85. And if they're driving down the street and they see an E85 station that says, you know, you're selling it at $2.50 a gallon and gasoline is $3.50 a gallon, that seems to me to be a pretty attractive proposition. The last thing I will say is this. There is some reason to believe that there are some emission reduction benefits that could be achieved by operating these fuels on E85. That's less clear with newer vehicles, which have very tight emission standards, but it certainly appears that for pre-2007 vehicles, there are likely to be significant emission reduction benefits, and that may be an opportunity for people who want to promote these conversion kits to try to get concentrations of those kits in certain areas where it would not only be economically attractive if there's a fuel supplier that can sell at $2.50 a gallon, but also result in significant benefits in terms of hydrocarbons and NOx, which is a public benefit that RFF really looked at a little bit but didn't have good enough data to consider. So I think that's something that needs to be considered as part of this whole process.